So the next section is St. Arnaud to Hanmer Springs for southbounders. This section is 74 and a half miles. And when you leave the town of St. Arnaud, it's kind of confusing. That's why I kept that first piece of film slow-mo. That trail sign is actually right outside of the Alpine Lodge Hotel. So follow that trail sign and it will deposit you into this car park, which will start your track walking. And also I want to point out in St. Arnaud, if you are planning on staying at some of these huts, such as Upper Traverse Hut, if you're planning on staying in a bunk, you do have to get a special use permit from the DOC. If you do have a backcountry hut pass, you're allowed to camp outside of them, but you're not allowed to stay in the hut itself. It does require a special use pass due to the popularity of this trail. So when you leave the town, you start this kind of lakeside walk, which is really gorgeous, really easy cruising. You can hold a very standard pace on this, anywhere from 2 miles to 3 miles per hour, even upwards of that if you so desire. This is the first hut that you'll pass, which I believe is called Traverse Hut. And please Google me and correct me if I'm wrong there. But also I want to point out that hut. So it is a bigger hut, anywhere from 20 bunks upwards, but it is going to be very, very popular. As you saw in a couple scenes prior, there is a car park there and people actually can even catch a boat to hike back into that hut for camping during the night. So it is going to be popular with tourists. Again, use your own preference here, opinion. If you want to stay there, that's also great. So if you decide to go past that hut, as you saw, beautiful sweeping grasslands, and then you start getting into more chunkier tracks such as this. Not necessarily hard, it's just slower going, more rocks, more roots, what have you. You cross a bridge across the river, and this will kind of signify when you begin your overall ascent. You do still do have these longer kind of flat portions, but you will be climbing in your future. And here's another river track section that shows you kind of the quality of the rocks, the roots, what have you. And you cross another bridge, get into this forested section, and the forested section is really beautiful through here. I've said this before, but just this entire area I really enjoyed. This section in general was probably one of my personal favorite sections along the entire TA. Again, it's only opinion here. So these signs have a lot of avalanche signs, and during the winter time, yeah, it would have avalanche, but during the summertime when most people hike the TA, you notice the avalanche just due to kind of the cut in the tracks. There's somewhat landslides through here, and just more chunky track, more rocks, and sometimes you can see like full rock fields that came down the mountain. It's easy to navigate, it's just gonna be that slower going again. I thought Magpie was gonna cross that puddle right there. This is why I kept that clip in. It just amused me that she found a drier way around. And you can also find a drier way around if you so desire. So this is more of that bouncy track I was talking about. It is still gradually trending upward. It's a slow gradual ascent in the beginning, but it is gradually trending upward. And this is more of that avalanche field that I was talking about. You can see all the rocks came down off of that top of the mountain. And there's nice cairns there. There's nice trail logos, trail signs on the trees that will point your way forward. So you get to this very kind of open grass field, and this will signify the start or the entrance to Upper Traverse Hut. Upper Traverse Hut, as I said, you need a special use permit. You can see we pitched a tent. There is not many options to have a flat spot for tenting around here. You could probably fit two or three, and they're not at the hut themselves. They're a little bit offset from there. So if you're planning on camping, there's not many options, so be prepared for that. So if you start the next day, you have a few options. There's more huts in your future. A lot of people decide to go to Blue Lake Hut. We decided to push past just because it linked up with our schedule better, but I'll talk about that more once we get there. I wasn't saying anything important in that clip. It was just a nice shot, I thought. This is Upper Traverse Hut, and you cross this bridge and start your climb up to Traverse Saddle proper. And the initial part of the climb is nice. It's dirt track. You can kind of hold a very standard pace on that. Once you get closer to the top itself, the track quality starts changing to more rock, and that rock will slow down the pace. So you can see off to the right is where you go. Follow those orange posts. The orange posts are going to be your friend from pretty much the Richmond Ranges last video onwards for the rest of the South Island. You just look for those orange posts and go for it. So usually they do coincide with nice single track though, or more beaten down single track. So a lot of the time it's not cross country, but single track. So this is the top of Traverse Saddle. Gorgeous views up here. Take a photo, take a break, take some lunch, whatever it may be. Just epically gorgeous. There is no water up here, so highly recommend carrying from, there's a spring right before Traverse Hut, about 0.1 before for southbounders, or there's water at the tap at Traverse Hut that you can carry from there to the next hut. So, as you can see, just epically gorgeous through there. Once you get done with those view portions, you do drop down into the forest, back into the portion along the riverbed, new riverbed, and more of those micro ups and downs that you're probably used to at this point along your hike. There are a couple pinch points that will impact your pace, such as this. Muddier sections, again, it's nothing compared to the North Island mud. It's very small pockets of mud, not consistent long portions. And overall, the pace is pretty standard. So this is West Sabine Hut, a bigger hut again. It looks like a newer model. I didn't get a whole lot of film of the inside. There are a lot of folks inside, and I wanted to be polite, but it is a nice hut, and you can stay there if you so desire. If you decide to go past that, you start more of a steeper ascent up to Blue Lake Hut proper. And Blue Lake Hut, I didn't get film of this hut, again, due to wanting to be polite with everybody around there. But Blue Lake proper, I want to point this out. The hut itself has kind of a word of caution that the tank is usually dry. So, by doing your part, they have flagging tape down to a spring where you can actually fill up your water. Big disclaimer in here, Magpie got a little sick from it. We met another hiker that got sick, and then we had friends in New Zealand that had hiked it a week or two prior, and they also got sick from this water around here. So highly recommend treating it or doing what you need to do to make yourself feel comfortable in that situation. So this is more of the climb up towards Blue Lake Hut. I did want to put that piece of information in there because that is very important. Again, Blue Lake Hut, I believe you need a special use pass to stay there. Double check me on that or Google that if you so desire. If you decide to go past Blue Lake Hut, you will start a more bigger climb up to Wahoo Pass. But the climb to Wahoo Pass is actually, quote unquote, in my opinion, easier than this connecting piece. And this is the connecting piece right here. We passed Blue Lake Hut a few scenes ago. Again, I didn't film it, but this is by far, my opinion, one of the harder portions of this entire section. So it goes straight up that scree field, as you see to Magpie's right. That's the easy part. It's just steep, slower pace, what have you. But then it's the mile or so that connects you along the side of this lake, and it drops you steeply down this backside, as you see here. I tried to do it justice. Again, the film doesn't really show you how steep that is and how loose that rock is. Very slow going, so anticipate your pace will get hit. You'll drop back down to the lakeside, get a go around the lake for a little bit, and then you'll start climbing Wahoo Pass. One of my favorite, if not my favorite, pass of the entire Te Araroa Trail. It is the steepest climb I think we had experienced to date, barring some climbs in the Richmond Ranges, even maybe steeper than those. It is very steep. I kept this piece of film very long to show you how far away Magpie is and how steep the route is. Again, it's hard for the camera to do justice to that, but it shows you just how steep it is. And this is the probably idyllic photo you see of many, many people that experience the TA, tourists, what have you. A lot of people take a photo right at that spot. So this is getting closer to the Wahoo Pass. It's right up in that U or V, and this is the official top. And once you get to the official top, you drop down the backside, epic views up here, take a lunch, take break, take a photo. It is just epically gorgeous. And when you drop down the backside, again, expect your miles to take a hit because you're doing more rock climbing for the first anywhere from half mile to a mile downhill. There are portions that you can walk, but there is a high percentage that you're just rock climbing down these things. Again, it's not the type of rock climbing that if you fall, you'll die per se. You just will be more uncomfortable than you prefer. So make sure you're secure. As you can see, you can kind of wedge yourself in the rock as Magpie's doing there. She does it a different way than I do. She hikes, climbs down backwards. But again, everybody's own opinion preference. It will just dictate your pace. You're not going very quick through there at all. So if you're planning to get to the river camp spot on the other side and you get to Wahoo Pass late in the day, there thankfully is a tabletop before you do the second half of the descent, which is ultimately easier. But if it's starting to get dark, there is a tabletop that you can camp on down there that I'm pointing at right now. And that's where we camped. Epically gorgeous. There's a creek to the left of the tent here. Nice spring, not spring water, but kind of snow melt. No filter, no problem. So this is just by far one of our favorite camp spots of the TA. So if your miles link up, know that there is this kind of quote-unquote emergency camp before the official camp spots down by the river. So if you decide to camp there and push on the next day, this day is far easier than your prior 2 days, not nearly as much climbing. You still have those micro ups and downs that I've talked about down by the riverbeds in general, but overall, way easier terrain. So you'll start with a very long descent down to the river proper, and this descent far easier than the first half mile to a mile down Wahoo Pass. You can hold pretty standard pace on this, anywhere from that 2 mile per hour to 3 mile per hour range. There are pinch points that will make you go slower, but it's not rock climbing anymore. You're walking, albeit a little bit slower than you do in normal circumstances. So that's the riverbed down there that I was talking about. You do cross it. I don't foresee it getting to any flood levels. It was about shin high on us. But again, use your best judgment. Check weather forecasts. Cannot stress that point enough. For all of the South Island, always check the weather forecast for the section you're going into, because the trail can drastically change due to rain. So this is the river miles I was talking about. Just slower going along this rock. Magpies in that right corner of your screen right now. And ultimately, you'll start fluctuating with more easy walking trail, this type of stuff. Just kind of single track across these broad plains. There is still rocks in there that'll ultimately slow your pace down. But as you get closer and closer to the next hut, the trail gets easier and easier and easier. A lot of camping options down here. Once you pass that first river, a few miles past that, is when these camping options just became pretty much unlimited. A lot of flat spot, a lot of tree spots, a lot of open prairie spots or open plain spot, a lot of places to camp. This is the hut I was talking about. And if you decide to push past that hut, it is around a 6 to 8 bunker. But if you decide to push past it, the miles just keep getting easier, easier, and easier. You'll be able to hold a really, really good pace along this stuff. This is actually off trail. We just decided to take a quick lunch break here. So don't worry about all those rocks. The trail is actually in the forest up to our right there. But you ultimately will start getting into these valley sections. And these valley sections are going to repeat themselves more on the South Island in your future. But they're just long, easy walking. It's a pseudo mixture of that single track, two track that I've been talking about. Sometimes it gets narrower, sometimes it gets wider. It's just very dependent. You do have a couple stream crossings, which was actually pretty good because if it's hot out there, you will need some water. A lot of the sources this day is that river or connecting streams. Water's not really an issue this day. You always are pretty close to it. Just some places are more easily accessible than others. So as you continue on, most people end up pushing to the next hut called An Hut. And An Hut is on this sign here. And if I filmed this sign, because you see that time split says 6 hours. And we ended up hitting another sign in about 30 minutes that ended up saying only 3 hours. So those DOC signs, this is it here. It was 30 minutes away from that prior sign. So 3 hours got shaved off the time in 30 minutes. So again, use your best judgment, but sometimes those DO signs don't make any sense. Sometimes they make good sense, especially in the Richmond ranges, but use your own best judgment. More water crossings along the way, nothing too major. They're not long, they're not prolonged. You're just kind of crossing them and going up into the plain again. I kept this piece of film because this is a very confusing spot. Right before the St. James Walkway, there's this turn, and it's a very sharp turn. To the left actually has the orange post, but you actually take a sharp right. So for southbounders, just be aware, check your maps. Before that same St. James Walkway, about a mile or so before, there's a very sharp turn that you should be aware of. So you get into the St. James Walkway, easy walking, and then it puts you into more of this single track here that will connect you into Anne's Hut, or Anne's Saddle Hut. Little overgrown in portions, but you can still hold that standard pace on it. And that's Anne's Hut in the distance. It does have water, a lot of camping options outside. We did not stay there. We did wanted to get closer to town proper, so we pushed on. If you do decide to push on, the camping you would think would be good, but there's only camping that really starts around 3 miles past Anne's Saddle, somewhere in that ballpark. Not a whole lot of good spots due to the overgrowth. So as you can see, it's very overgrown. The ground itself is flat, but due to the overgrowth, it would be very hard to pitch a tent in this type of stuff. So if you are pushing past Anne's Hut, the first feasible camp spots are really within that 3 mile window, maybe right underneath it. And a lot of the flat ground that I just panned to right here is just very soggy, so that's not really an option either unless you want a soggy sleep. So this is where the first camping options really started to take place, about 3 miles after that hut. And you're right next to a water source. You got a lot of accessible water. Sand flies are an issue here, so hop into your tent very quickly if you want to avoid getting eaten alive. The next day, depending where people camp, and saddle, past it, whatever you have, many people push into Hanmer Springs, or more accurately, the Boyle Outdoor Center. So the Boyle Outdoor Center is a place you can send a resupply box. We didn't have this piece of information and it would have been crucial. Cannot recommend enough trying to send a box there if you don't want to do a 40-mile off-trail hitch into Hanmer Springs. Hanmer Springs is a great town, but it is an extremely far hitch. So do your planning, send a box to Boyle Outdoor Center, and they do have pizza, sodas. They don't really have a store, but they have like a little cabin for hikers. You can do shower, laundry, what have you. So again, do your own research here. You can go to Boyle Outdoor Center or Hanmer Springs, but if you want to avoid that big hitch, send a box to Boyle Outdoor Center. So the morning miles, as you saw, you got to hand saddle. It was a gradual climb. It wasn't too bad. And as you drop down the backside of In Saddle, you have more of this stuff, those more micro ups and downs, and it will eventually connect you into another kind of riverside track. The riverside track fluctuates with quality. I kept these two pieces of film in here because one, there's a hut out there and it looked like the trail. Magpie crossed the bridge, came back across the bridge. The first swinging bridge, don't cross it. It just brings you off trail to a hut. Continue on this way along the river track itself. And as I said, it fluctuates. There's sometimes these landslide portions, pretty easy to navigate, just slower going. I kept this long just to kind of show you what those portions of landslide look like. They're not too dangerous, in my opinion. Again, on personal preference here, you can navigate them pretty easily. You do cross one final swinging bridge before the river, Boyle River swing bridge. And this will connect you into another portion of track on the other side of the river. And if you were holding a good pace prior in the day, this is when your pace will start dropping a little bit. As you saw with the prior scene, it's just chunkier track. You do have some of these clear portions in there, but the ratio is more slow going track than quick growing track. I apologize. So you have that wash out there. You have to climb up it. There's always something fun each day in New Zealand. You really never know. It's just the land gets so saturated. So this is the Boyle River. You cross this final swinging bridge and you can really open up your pace from here. Boyle Outdoor Center is another 3 miles, 2 miles, somewhere in that ballpark from here. And it's nice single track and it'll ultimately lead you into two track that will connect you into the Boyle Outdoor Center. This is it. Again, cannot stress enough. Sending a box here. We wish we would have, so we could have avoided the hitch. Boyle Outdoor Center is really friendly to TA hikers. If you do decide to hitch, the road to hitch to Hanmer Springs is right outside the Boyle Outdoor Center, so they will give you cardboard to write something on and try your hand at hitching. The hitch in is easy. The hitch out is more difficult because there's only one road that leads into Hanmer Springs, but there are a few roads that lead out of Hanmer Springs, and for people going to Boyle Outdoor Center, the traffic is way less. So again, only given information here, use your best judgment, whatever you want to do. But Hanmer Springs is a big tourist town. They actually have fairly reasonably priced accommodation due to just how many motels they do have there. And if you're staying there, they do have a spring that you can soak in. Again, we did not, due to just kind of being kind of in a confusion state. Magpie didn't sleep well the night before. She slept like an hour, so we took an unplanned rest day. You don't really need to know that, but great food in this town. A lot of restaurants. Again, it's a very touristy town, so it has the amenities that most tourist towns have. Great food, lodging, beautiful parks, and just everything's kind of accessible there. If you are going into Hanmer Springs, it is a nice spot to kind of recharge because you're getting into more and more wildernessy sections on the South Island where these towns are more spaced apart, as you've been seeing with the videos, longer sections. So do what you want to do here. It's really up to you. And I want to point out again, the hitching out of Hanmer Springs, you are going to take a little bit because you have to hitch to a main highway. And then from that main highway, it'll be towards Boyle Outdoor Center. It will be a two-part hitch. Most people take anywhere from an hour to 2 hours, but you could get unlucky with depending on the traffic. So just use that information as you will and get ready for the next section. Sugar up, food up, whatever is your preference, and get ready for some more beautiful South Island.